Well, hello to all of you, and welcome. I wanted to do something, and I wanted to make available and let a lot of people know who don't use these environments what a pleasure it is actually to enter into this kind of educational environment. The ease that it brings in terms of access to the information and the fact that it's interactive and that it is global, and it is very exciting. And so it's nice to have you all here to use or inaugurate the IHDS reception area. And what I'm really am going to deal with tonight or today is the basics. And I haven't visited the basics in a long time. And it's an interesting thing about going deeper and deeper and deeper into knowledge. Every moment that you take a step back, you realize that everything leads back to the surface. Everything leads back to the simple. And that all the mysteries are really just laid out there in front of us. And so the theme for today, the vehicle, the passenger, and the driver, well, it takes me back to the very beginning of my process in human design. And when I first began working with the knowledge, this is the way that I looked at things. There was the body graph, obviously, sitting there in the center. And there were these two wheels, you know, these wheels with their synthetic layers of zodiacal constellations and hexagrams of the I Ching. It's the way that I looked at things, because each of them is different. Truly, they're different. I mean, we live in an illusion, and we live in a dense illusion that is created by our self-reflected consciousness, the illusion that we are a wholeness, that we are a oneness. It is that very illusion that has driven us to try to see the wholeness and the oneness in everything, in everything. But we're not about oneness. We're not. Everything about the human design system is that the human design system, to its very core, is dualistic. It is about this and that. Everything is about this and that. And it is something to understand about the most fundamental dilemma that is, how do you live in one of these forms and live a life that is correct and rewarding and fulfilling? How you do that? And humanity struggles with that. They struggle with their minds. They struggle with the way in which they try to make sense out of the phenomena of their lives. They suffer deeply, in fact. And that suffering is rooted in this deep, deep assumption of wholeness, and it's not there. We are a duality. We are very much a duality. And one of the jokes of the nature of our duality is that we've been putting all of our faith, all of our trust, all of our hope into one aspect of the duality at the expense of the other. I mean, when you're looking at these two wheels in the body graph, let's look at it a different way for a moment. Let's look at it this way. Let's think about these mechanisms and what these mechanisms are all about. In essence, it takes me back to the very beginning of my work in human design. In some ways, that's what this particular lecture reminds me of. I spent many, many years traveling from place to place introducing the human design system. And introducing the basic construct of human design, how it works. And I would go back and I would start with the Big Bang, you know. Start with the beginning of the host story. Start with the crystals of consciousness, And it's something to think about. According to the mythology of this knowledge, in the beginning there were two crystals, yang and yin. Now, however you want to dress up the mythology, the way the story goes is that when the yang and the yin banged into each other, they shattered. And in the course of that shattering, all along the track of 15 billion years of movement, that each and every one of us has an aspect from that source. I remember doing a lecture in Sedona in Arizona. And after the lecture, some person came up to me and said to me, "Oh dear, you're an old soul." And I said to her, "Well, we all are. That is, we all started at the same time. We all started way back there in the beginning. These crystals of consciousness. And we have two. We're endowed with two crystals of consciousness, which means that we are a binary consciousness, a binary consciousness. Not what you describe or think of as mind. We are a binary consciousness. The personality crystal, this aspect of the original yang. When the neutrino stream goes through the personality crystal, what you get is who you think you are. But of course, that's a joke. And it's a good joke once you get it. But that's what happens. The information goes through the crystal. And the crystal, in its uniqueness, as the information goes through, it comes out as who you think you are. And you can see all that personality crystal information in your design. You can see it in every black line that's drawn in the body graph. This is who you think you are. And if you look at a body graph, the way in which we use them, the way in which they are part of the reality now, if you look at that body graph, look at the black. Well, there's a little here, and there's a little there, and there's some over here, and there's a little one over there, and there's one over there, and one over there. And when you're looking at the black, that's who you think you are. Now, what about the rest? What about all this stuff? What about the red? Who you think you are is not, in fact, at all who you are. It's who you think, or who you think you are. This is the personality. When we look at the design crystal is something else. Because the design crystal is very, very unique. It's unique in the sense that it operates directly with the magnetic monopole. And it is the design crystal that is when the neutrino stream goes through the design crystal that what you get is the generation of the vehicle, the form itself, the form itself. Design crystals and monopoles, they have something deeply in common. What they have in common, we could anthropomorphize and call love. That is, if we could anthropomorphize it, that their desire for each other is profound as one can imagine. When a design crystal is out of manifestation, it is out of manifestation with its magnetic monopole. Like a form and a mold. Together. And in that togetherness, there is no potential for the generation of any form. And yet the moment that they are a participant in the conception process, the moment that there is the beginning of what we call a life, is the moment that they must separate. and they will separate until the moment that you die. And in fact, the moment that you die is the moment that they stop being separate. And your life, your whole life, everything that you value as life, is all in between. I mean, think about the conception process. In the first 6 months, if we're looking at approximately a normal pregnancy of a human, that in that first 6 months, all you have is the design crystal and the monopole working together to create the form, and the personality is not even there. It is the passenger. And there is no point in having a passenger for a vehicle that has not been built. And the vehicle is built in the relationship between the design crystal and the monopole. And remember, this design crystal, this is a consciousness crystal. It is the consciousness of your vehicle, your body consciousness. I mean, you know, anyone knows, that if we were given responsibility mentally to have to look after what needs to be done for our body at a biological level, moment by moment by moment, we would fail miserably. Our body has a consciousness. And we have spent millennia and millennia ignoring it. Ignoring it. You know, all in favor of the passenger. All in favor of who you think you are. And never for a moment, never for a moment living out what you actually can be. And then we have the driver. And the driver is the great mystery. It's the great wonder. The magnetic monopole, you know, that monopole, that single pole. Always attracting. And it has two functions. It holds us together in the illusion of our separateness. Well, think about what that really means. We are what we are because of it. It holds us together in the illusion of our separateness. And that separateness is the components of what we are. This drawing, it really puts things in its proper perspective. The domain of the design crystal consciousness, the domain of the personality crystal consciousness, and the synthetic environment. And that synthesis, the quantum, is achieved by the influence of the monopole. It's the monopole holding the design and the personality together in this illusion of separateness. And not only does the monopole hold us together in the illusion of our separateness, but it aligns us to our specific geometry and moves us in space. This is the driver. Now let's think about something for a moment. When you're looking at a human design calculation, your human design calculation, there's an obvious to begin with. This calculation and this calculation are 88 degrees of the sun in movement apart, approximately 3 months apart. Now what that means is that you have two entirely different databases. They're different. I mean, they are very different from each other. It's the first thing to really get. The sacred marriage. You know, you've heard this in the New Age, the so-called sacred marriage. It's within us. It's within. You see, the personality, well, the personality has a rough ride. It does. And it doesn't want to know the truth that it's not really important. You know? That it isn't intended to be responsible for the life. It isn't. That its opinions about going this way or that way are folly. And it is truly left out of the game. Truly. You see, everything about living on the material plane is about the form. We're a bioform. We live in the illusion of a deeply material and physical plane. And the reality is that we have been ignoring that aspect of our nature, that aspect of our consciousness that is specifically concerned with our viability and survivability on the material plane. See, what human design brings is something very basic. It's very basic. You know, when somebody asks me, what is it? I tell them that it's just about decision making. And it is. Everything about transforming your life is transforming the way in which you make decisions. You see, we have given for millennia and millennia and millennia the responsibility for making decisions to the personality, that thing that thinks it is us that it is not. That thing that thinks that it is the driver, that it is the vehicle, it is not. It has no control over any of that. Helpless. And yet it's always been making the decisions. Always. I mean, there's a real joke. You know, it's a wonderful one. If you look at the body graph, you'll see that the head center is the only center that actually penetrates outside of the schematic of the physical body. And that's where the personality crystal resides. I mean, even when the design and the monopole have completed building the fetus into a viable form, being able to build a brain that has the potential of the neocortex and the possibility of self-reflected consciousness, in other words, when the back seat is available for the passenger and the passenger gets called in, it doesn't even get called into the body itself. That's just there for a ride. It's what we are as consciousness. Our personality consciousness, you and me, our passengers. They're here for the ride. They're not here to do. They're here for the ride. They're here to see. They're here to look out the window. They're here to watch the movie. But they're not here to be the driver. They're not here to be the vehicle because they cannot. You know, I started by saying that this is all about the simple. Yeah, simple. But boy, is that ever a challenge. I mean, I know I've been doing this a very long time now. What a challenge for passengers to give up their false authority. What a challenge. So used to it. It's the way you're conditioned. It's the way you're brought up. Everybody's your authority. I mean, everybody's your authority. You know, Allah's your authority, or Jesus is your authority, or the president or prime minister or this or that is your authority. The lawyer is your authority, and the cop's your authority, and the teacher's your authority, and your lover's your authority, your damn dog's your authority. I mean, everything about the simple is understanding that this is about decision-making, and we've been giving the decision-making to the wrong part of the whole system. We handed it over to the personality. Here, you know. Make decisions based on not knowing instead of here. It's what human design brings. It brings a movement in what is authority. And it's taking the authority away from mind, and it's returning the authority to the vehicle. To the vehicle's consciousness. You know, it is the vehicle that knows precisely how to act according to what is correct for you. Every human being incarnates on this plane with the potential to differentiate. Every human being. Each and every one of us are a unique filter of the neutrino ocean. We all have a potential to be able to filter that uniquely and perfectly as ourselves. It's what we're here for, to be unique. And that uniqueness is not simply a matter of thinking that that is expressed through the personality. But you have to begin to understand that the personality is always a byproduct of the correctness of the vehicle. I mean, think about your brain. The physical brain, not your mind. The physical brain. You know, and I know, if we do damage to that physical brain, that the personality is immediately going to be impacted. In fact, we can turn the personality right off and still maintain the life. It is something to grasp about the nature of the brain, is that each and every one of us are designed to differentiate at that physical level. Our brains are designed to differentiate. There's an extraordinary growth of physical brain capacity that takes place in the first 3 years of life. And then there's a mysterious culling that takes place at that point, where neural tracts that have been opened up get shut down. And basically, all children are homogenized in terms of brain potential function at that point in their lives. Recent studies have indicated that children that are particularly gifted, that they continue to have neural expansion until they are 5 or 6 years old. And they're fighting against the tide of conditioning. You see, if our entire physical domain, our bodies, are intended to be truly unique, remember, uniqueness is not a question of personality. Personality is a reflection of the uniqueness of the form. And that's not simply about the form's well-being, your digestion, and so forth. But it's also about the capacity of the form to be a platform. In the deeper studies of human design, that is, studies that go beneath the line, we have a level that is called tonal. And in the tonal level, the architecture of the vehicle is designed. And it is designed with one thing in mind: cognition. Cognition. Everything about life, everything about life in this particular variation of the bioform, everything about it is to achieve cognition. These brains of ours are extraordinary hardware. The dilemma that we have is that as long as the body is not correct, then nothing else can be. You know, whatever, love, your sense of self, the material plane, sexuality, you know, on and on and on. The dilemma of what it means to be so open to conditioning. Human design brings the simple. And the simple is to bring authority to the form and allow the form to make the decisions. Let the vehicle and the driver, let them do their job. You know, the moment that you give them that authority, you align your movement on this plane. You align it to its correctness. There's something fascinating to think about. At least, it is for me. When I first began this process, I was not somebody that was well schooled in the esoteric or the spiritual mystical. When I began my process, it seemed to me that if you could get somebody to follow their strategy and authority, that you could get them to wake up. And I'm beginning to see something that is simply a continued affirmation of the fact that we are a very, very clear duality. When you follow your strategy and authority, you align your vehicle to what is correct for it. That is enormously beneficial. That is, it's beneficial on the physical plane. It's good for your health. It is good for your material life. It is good for your movement in this life. And in fact, your life is transformed by that. But that does not mean automatically that the passenger, who has no access to all of this, the passenger who has always been the center of authority, that the passenger can easily surrender to what is a new situation. It cannot. It cannot. See, the passenger has a lot to learn. It's what it really comes down to. I mean, the passenger has a lot to learn. This is the thing that allows the passenger to finally get to a place where it is not simply being forced to surrender. It accepts the transformation of its role in this process. When you enter into this experiment correctly, you give authority over to what is your true inner authority. In that moment, you begin a journey with your mind. With your mind. I mean, I love mind. I think it's important to understand I am not somebody who thinks that mind is the enemy. It is not. The fact that mind has been given responsibility for what it is not equipped for, you know, is a historical conditioned phenomena. Mind is beautiful. It's wonderful for seeing. And when you begin to use your mind to see, instead of using your mind as an employee of your life, you can begin to appreciate its beauty. It is very, very difficult for the passenger to stand back. To just stand back. You know that. You know how deeply involved your mind is in your life. Oh, is it involved? In all of the possibilities of this and that and the other thing, and all of the things that go whirling through, and how easy it is for one of those things to get you to make that decision. This is about the simple, after all. And when you think about the simple, think about just the difference between the fixed and the open. See, we're a bioform. We're genetic based, gene-based bioform. And the genes have an imperative, and the imperative is to survive through reproduction. And if you're a bioform, you know that in reproduction, that reproduction is only going to be successful and viable for the species when you have the bondings of difference rather than sameness. We are designed to be deeply attracted to what we are not. To what we are not. And that deep attraction to what we are not is mental. It's mental. It's all mind. And being deeply attracted to what we're not, and that it is all mind, then you have to see that what mind is going to do in this life for you is going to make decisions based on what you are not, what you're not. We call it the not self. And the not self, it brings so much discomfort. Look at this being, this design, and think about the not self. Here's somebody that has an open heart center. Not broken, not empty, doesn't need to be fixed, just not consistent, just sitting there. And it carries with it a not-self strategy. That strategy is a direct emergence from what happens to that center when it amplifies being connected by somebody else. And the strategy of the open heart center is about always having to prove yourself. Always having to prove yourself worthy. The great promise breakers. Now think about the mind of this being, the not-self mind of this being. And the not-self mind of this being comes to a fork in the road. And whatever that fork in the road happens to be, whether it's to do this job or that job, be with this person or not, and so forth and so on, it gets to that fork in the road, and how does it make that decision? It doesn't make that decision with its body consciousness. It tries to make that decision with its mind. It tries to formulate. You know, it tries to strategically figure it out which way to go. But it's not that simple. That open center becomes a condition of making that decision. I will go left because it's going to prove that I'm a good person. I will go right even though I hate it because I promised to do it. And on and on. And there's 5 open centers. And myriad open gates. Open channels. All under the influence of the other. All becoming conditions upon which this mind that is not this person's authority will make decisions. Based on everything it's not. Open emotional system. The not-self strategy of the open emotional system is to avoid confrontation and truth. If I go left, will I avoid confrontation and truth? Good, then I'll go left. It has nothing to do with who this being is. This is the passenger in the back seat, trying to run the whole show. It's not equipped. It can't. And it is only making a decision for what it is not. It's not capable of making a decision based on what it is. I mean, the passenger is interesting. The passenger works so hard at trying to figure out what it's all about, and all it has to do is sit back and see. And all the fears about life, human beings with their endless trips and their hang-ups, this not self domain, making decisions over and over again with the mind, you get this crazy not self world we live in, where babies die every second because there aren't pennies and services for diarrhea. That we live in the madness of a homogenized, normal world, all based on decisions that have nothing to do with truth. Human design is really about understanding that when you give the authority to the vehicle, only then, can you begin the journey to awakeness. It's where it all starts. It's not about this mantra and that magic potion and this thing and that thing. Truly, it is not. It's not. It's about understanding that what created our life is what we need to respect. It is what gives us our life and all of its potential. The visual, the acoustic, the tactile, everything that goes with being a being, the brain that supports the self-reflected consciousness, all of that is the vehicle. And what the vehicle takes in as nutrition, what the vehicle takes in as other beings in its life, that all of this must be conditioned by the vehicle's authority, ruled by the vehicle's authority. It is the magic of strategy and authority. You know, it's what it brings. And in the very act of experimenting with your strategy and authority, in the very act itself, for perhaps the very first time in all your incarnations, you have finally cut the chains of your passenger to its illusion. It's the beginning. It's the beginning. You know, I started many years ago. I had some lines that would crank people up, and one of my favorites was no choice. No choice. And you see, this is something the mind has to grasp so deeply. I mean, it's not like this is some kind of esoteric, new agey thing. I mean, if you understand the neurology, the way in which information in the brain moves. You know, we know that everything that we think and say and do, which is everything, everything we think and say and do is initiated in the deep gray areas of the brain before we have any conscious access to it. You know, that this or that or whatever that your self-reflected consciousness is aware of, that it was already initiated long before it was aware of it. It's not like the personality, the mind, the passenger has any control over anything. It does not. It doesn't. It's not what it's here for. I mean, that's the journey. You know, the journey is to return the passenger to its rightful condition. Oh, the beauty of being able to sit in the back seat and not be concerned about your vehicle, and not be concerned about where it is going, not feeling like you're on 24-hour call, that at any moment you're going to have to decide this or that, and that if you fail, you know, and on, the could-haves, would-haves, might-haves, should-haves. Oh no, it's beautiful. You know, you just sit back and you look out the windows and you watch and you see. It's our gift. It's our gift. It's where our minds are so beautiful. See, the moment that we're dealing with a world in which there are those that have a true inner authority, it begins the possibility of being in a world where personalities truly make a unique contribution. A unique contribution. This is not about that one being or one mind is the answer. It's about understanding that this is the liberating of unique authority, both physical and intellectual. I can only be a valid representative of what it is to be on the cross of the clarion as a manifester, you know, my particular perspective. It's my contribution. It's what mine's for. My mind is good or interesting for you. It is not good for me. My mind does not make decisions for me in this life. It doesn't. It was terrible at it when it did. Terrible. It's not what it's about. But mind, when it's freed, then it can begin to make a contribution. We do not yet have any real sense of how profound human consciousness can be. All we have is homogenized concepts. It's all we have. Homogenized concepts. You know, the 2 billion people will believe the same nonsense at the same time. Homogenized concepts. Human design is about the individual. And I mean that in the sense of the singular being. It is what this knowledge is for. It is why this knowledge is here now. It is here now because there is an enormous momentum that is placing incredible pressure on the viability of groups, on the viability of infrastructures, support infrastructures, that the future for our children, for our grandchildren, for our great-grandchildren, and on and on and on, is going to be dependent on the ability to be able to operate correctly as oneself, as your own unique authority. You know, these are just words. I know they're just words. I don't know how to translate the feeling that I have in my life as my own authority. I don't know the words to describe that level of liberation. The incredible, incredible freedom that comes with knowing that at any moment, anywhere, anytime, that within yourself is the essential decision. Always. And in that grows something that I think is the greatest gift of all. And that is to be able to love yourself. To love yourself. It was a horror for me when I first went out with this knowledge and sat with people by the thousands and did their analyses. I was appalled. They couldn't stand themselves. You could feel it the moment that they walked into the room. You could feel it the moment that you touched something that they really didn't like about themselves. You could see how hard it was for them to look in the mirror and see the grace that they've been given. Oh, it was awful. It was also a bad joke. You know, they disliked somebody who wasn't them. They had never known who they were. They had never been able to live this life in such a way that they could see the beauty of why they are here. that through that experience of living correctly as themselves, the contribution that they could make to the other, the awareness that arises from that. It's astonishing. And human beings are trained not to like themselves by living in a homogenized, conditioned world. You don't look as good as the kid next door, or, you know, goes on and on and on. See, the simple. I've been telling people to do the same thing for a long time. Because it is simple. And yet to really grasp something that it works. And it's more than that. It opens up something that is only here now. Now. You see, we have the tools to grasp our essential nature. We have techniques that can allow us to operate correctly as ourselves. And we have a deep, deep understanding of the way the mechanics work. Any personality that has the geometry to be involved in this process has the possibility, has their possibility, to ultimately express their unique mental contribution. What can you tell me about the cross upon which you stand, from the profile and the design that you have? What do you see? I don't see the same thing. We do not have respect for the extraordinary potential of unique awareness. We don't. You know, we have all these myths about how we need to harmonize. We have all these myths about how we need to share. How these concepts are supposed to be, you know, uniform. We're entering into a new age. We're entering into an age in which the individual has to be equipped to operate correctly without dependency on the authority of others. And in operating correctly and not being dependent on the authority of others, the ability in that through their experience to have a unique perception that's here to be shared. I love those moments, Abisa events, when so many people who've been in the knowledge a long time just have casual conversations that are sort of related but not necessarily directly to design. And you can see how much is learned along this way. In the end, and it's really the last thing I want to share with you today, the moment that you truly can find your own authority, it opens up something that you have to deal with, you have to come to grips with, and that is the other. There is always the other. It is what we are about. And at the moment that you are correct, how important it is to understand that you need to be so clear about the forces that you allow into your life. And that this authority that you are blessed with, that you can have access to, that this authority will guarantee for you that the forces that enter into your life are correct. Because you see, when you stand alone and the conditioning field is all around you and forces that are incorrect for you are all around you, your body can survive that. But it's extraordinarily difficult for your mind to do so. The mind is the first victim of conditioning, always. So easy to condition the mind. And it simply goes back to your strategy and authority. It goes back to understanding that everything in your life needs to be reassessed relative to your true authority. And it doesn't matter what it is. I love the simple. It's healing. It's one of the most magical things about this knowledge is that you can say to a generator, look, just respond, you know. Just wait to respond. And those words, that key, I mean, if it weren't for the mind, it would spread like a virus. Because its power is so incredible to transform that being's life. And it's always mind. This passenger. And this is your challenge. It's everyone's challenge. The challenge of the passenger. The longer you're involved in operating correctly, the more you'll see that the passenger has less to gripe about and more to look at. But something else to understand. Once you're in this process and you truly want to get to a place where you can truly surrender to being a passenger, then there's much to learn. There is much to learn. To understand the way it works, to have confirmation over and over again in the mechanics, to prove in essence to mind the pointlessness of its trying to claim authority. And then to train it to see. And to see with your eyes. To see with your truth. Yeah, I'd like to see all that. That would be very nice.